I'd like to have the honor and privilege of presenting to you Mesumbe Alam Ebon. Mesumbe Alam is the chief initiator and chief promoter of AC Credit Bank. He worked with Spring Edge as international project coordinator. And during that process and his engagement in banking business and his engagement in international project management, so this idea was given birth to. He has been to Cameroon, and he was the one who signed agreement with investors that we have. So we shall be hearing from him, because he has been on the ground pursuing this project since 2009. So I would crave the indulgence to listen
carefully,
with all your heart and all your mind, because this is about sharing money. Clinton is looking at this man. Okay, we'd like to welcome Alan to the talk. Thank you so much.
I will listen very keenly from our eminent reverend concerning the impact, the socioeconomic impact of Africans in the diaspora and their contributions towards the achievement of the Millennium Development Goals, which is one of the main reasons why Exim Credit Bank is coming as an instrument to complement the efforts of Africans in the diaspora. Now, if you look at statistics, you realize that in 2010, Africans in the diaspora remitted a total sum of about $40 billion to Africa. That same year, if you look at statistics according to the International Fund for Agricultural Development, you realize that the amount of money that Cameroonians and Nigerians in the diaspora they sent to Cameroon is about $260 million per year. If you convert that money into CFA francs, it is approximately 140 billion francs CFA. If you convert the money into Swedish crowns, it is about 1.7 billion Swedish crowns per year. Now, if you calculate, if you put together all this money, you realize that, according to the analysis that Reverend Chikeze made, you realize that some of this money go into education, it go into health, it go into certain small activities that enhance the well-being of our families back home. But majority of this money is not coming in as investment. Some of this money only come to send children to school, to take care of sick people and all whatnot. Now, if you look at it, you realize that banks in Africa, they don't look at the needs of Africans in the diaspora. Now, you load a container, about 20 feet container, you go to a bank that you want a loan, and maybe to remove the container, they will tell you that you don't have collateral, you don't have this, you don't have this. But if you look at a very careful analysis, you realize that the minimum wage that each African in the diaspora earns per year is more than the salary of a minister in the country. Most Africans in the diaspora, they earn more than 15,000 Swedish crowns per month. That's the minimum wage, government rate. Now, if you analyze this income, you realize that if you take a loan in the bank, let's say in Africa, you'll be able to pay that loan within a twinkle of an eye, more than any civil servant or any government official in that very country who takes that, who attends this, the amount of money that you are earning is not even able. The amount of money that you earn can even pay him about three times or even four times per that period of time. So at this particular level now, we are looking at the possibility of trying to enhance the amount of remittance that Africans in the diaspora they send back home, so that this amount of money that is going into the economy should be used in a proper way in investment activities and other social activities that will enable them to create jobs and even try to reduce the level of poverty and try to enhance the achievement of the Millennium Development Goal by 2015. Now, let us move further. After analyzing the impact of remittance, the impact that it has in the alleviation of poverty and the enhancement of the Millennium Development Goals, you realize that there is a need for the creation of a diaspora-driven bank. A diaspora-driven bank is an instrument that is being put in place by a few Cameroonians in the diaspora and some reputable Cameroonians at home. Now, if you look at all these particular analysis, you realize that there is a need. There is a need now. There is a need now for Africans in the diaspora to own a bank. The bank will be a pan-African bank that will be open in so many African countries, beginning from Cameroon. That implies that in January 2018, if we open the doors in Cameroon, other Cameroonians, other Africans in the diaspora, they have the right to pull the bank to their respective countries. So I think that is just the idea of the whole issue. So now let us try to go detailing now on how it started. In 2008, after working with Spring Aid for some time as an international project coordinator, we had a series of meetings with some stakeholders like Real Money Transfer and some other partners. Now, in the course of that discussion, they came up with an idea of opening a microfinance, something of that nature. Now, we look at the possibility of trying to open a microfinance, we realize that opening a microfinance will not attract foreign investors in a way. So we decided now to look at the possibility of floating a full-fledged commercial bank, whereby I was assigned by the board to prepare a concept note that I prepared and we came up now with a full-blown business plan that was written in the US and then financed by Ebon Kingsley. Now, after writing the business plan, I will look at the possibility of trying to see how we can get investors. How do we get investors? Writing a business plan is one thing. Getting an investor is another thing. So how do we go about getting an investor? Now, we decided now, we went to the internet and started googling and trying to get some few investors. And we got one investor in Holland. We got another investor in Denmark. We got another investor in Norway and all whatnot. So after going through the website and trying to see what they are doing now, I realized that Holland, as you look at it, is not too transparent as Scandinavian countries, because you have a lot of scammers in the Netherlands. Because some people will tell you that they'll source for investors, you give them money, you pay their consultancy fee, you pay them that money, and at the end of the day, you will not trace them. So I made those analysis and I told Kingsley that Scandinavia is a very transparent country. It is better for us to deal with a consultant in Denmark than deal with a consultant in the Netherlands. So we got in touch now with Per Brogaard. Now, Per Brogaard now said that, Alan, you send me the business plan. Let us go through the business plan and let me see if it is feasible so that I will tell you whether I'll be able to do for investors or not. So from there now, we sent that business plan to Per Brogaard in Denmark, who read the business plan and told me that the business plan is feasible and he will be able to source for funding within 6 months. So at that time now, I got in touch with Reverend Chikeze and told him about the whole issue. He said that, well, let us try to prepare for a meeting so that at least all the board members of Africa, you know, at that time, they should meet and then we'll try to look at the whole thing and we'll see how we can schedule the meeting with Per Brogaard. We read the business plan, we look at it. Alois there was very instrumental since he's a business consultant. We look at the loopholes, we look at the pros and the cons, and we said that, well, let us schedule the meeting and we'll see where we can try to trash out this particular aspects in so many aspects in the business plan. That is the answers. And we needed clarification from Per Brogaard. So when Per Brogaard, at that time, I was sharing the meeting now with Per Brogaard, and Per Brogaard came. When Per Brogaard came, we held a meeting in African Union Conference Hall. That was attended by Ebon Kingsley, Reverend Chikeze, Alois, Tony Wahab, and a few other people. After brainstorming,
Père Broca said that we should pay his consultation fee of 15,000 Swedish crowns, which was paid by Tony Wahab. At that time, I was working. The income was not there to support anything. So Tony Wahab took the responsibility and paid the bill. Then now, we moved now to another level. I was writing emails to Père Broca, telling him how things are going and how or not. And when I was going to work in Baka, I got a call from Père Broca. He told me that he has a very important news for me. I said, okay. He said, can I have a conference call with you today? I said, yes. We gave the time and we scheduled a conference call in the office of Spring 8. Now, when I got that conference call now, he linked me up now to one of a very serious international consultant by name Azad. That's Père Broca. So, when he linked me up now with Azad now said that for his 47 years as a banker, he has never seen this type of business plan, because Azad happened to be the vice president of Happy Bank in Zurich. He said that he has never seen that type of business plan during his 47 years as a banker, because of the simple fact that the first innovation in the business plan was that the business plan carried the interest of Africans in the diaspora. It carried the interest of the general public, and it carried the interest of the local communities. That the way banks operate now, in those days, banks usually only accept deposits and make loans and all whatnot. But the role that banks are playing now is quite different, because the global community is becoming more and more dynamic. So as the more dynamic, the more complicated the world becomes, the more banks now have to tailor their products to meet the needs of the local community. So we decided to prepare that structure in that way, and Père Broca, as I said, that the business plan will serve. They said, but before I commit and I write a report to the international donor, international investors to finance this project, I have to go to Cameroon to see things for myself and then make a report at the end of my visit. After that, now we had another meeting, which was convened by Reverend Chikeze. We looked at everything, and then some people now came up with funds, preliminary expenses now, to see how I can travel to Cameroon. So in December 2009, I left for Cameroon, whereby Azad came about 2 months after in Cameroon, and he stayed for about 7 days, and we met the director of treasury, we met the person in charge of receiving files from the ministry of bank license application and all that. And the person exposed everything to us, the minimum amount of money that is required to open a bank, the documents that are required, and everything of that nature. So that information was given to Azad, and then we carried Azad to so many other towns, and then I carried him to a cocoa farm. I said, maybe you are in Mauritius like that, you are not even seeing cocoa. You are eating chocolate, but you are not even seeing cocoa. Let me carry you to this cocoa farm so that you see where cocoa comes from. So he went now and he saw the cocoa pods and all whatnot, and then he said that, Alan, Cameroon has a lot of potential. Yeah, I said, yes. I said, Cameroon is described as Africa in miniature, because Cameroon has everything. Cameroon has everything. He said, well, Alan, as it is like this, I think these investors will be able to finance this project, because we are looking at a very big opportunity in our hands here. I said, yes. I said, the opportunity is there. We need the money to make sure that we start. At that particular level, the business plan was saying that we need a capital of $10 million. Not knowing that the Ministry of Finance has raised the capital to $25 million. So that brought us down to square one. I called a consultant in the US. I said that they should rework the business plan, try to put all the projections to meet the new capital structure of $25 million. So we sent the business plan back to the US. They tailored it to meet that range of capital. Azad wrote his report, sent to the international donor organizations, and then after about a year, we got a commitment from an investor from Canada. Now, after the bank committed about $5 million, we signed the letter of intent and all whatnot. But after delaying to get the balance of the capital, the man took that money now